verse 1. We're going to apply these keys and we will see that the first beast of Revelation 13 have very similar descriptions to that of another entity that was prophesied in one of the visions from Daniel 7. I believe that just reading Revelation 13 in verse 1, when we apply these keys, you guys will have a clear understanding who this entity is. Revelation 13, starting from verse 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. Now let's apply the keys. So John saw a beast or a superpower rise up out of the sea or a densely populated area, having seven heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy, which means this superpower is going to claim to be God on earth, and he's going to claim to have the power to forgive sin. This should already give you a clear indication of who this entity might be. It is a superpower that comes out of a densely populated area, and he will claim to be God on earth, and he will claim to have the power to forgive sin. Very, very familiar. Verse number 2. And this beast, or this superpower, which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion, and the dragon, or Satan, or pagan Rome, gave him his power and his seat and great authority. So we have a superpower that comes out of a densely populated area. He will claim to be God on earth. He will claim to have the power to forgive sin. And pagan Rome gave him his power and seat and great authority. Who could that be? Let's keep going. And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world wondered after the beast, and they worshipped the dragon, or obeyed pagan Rome, which gave power unto the beast, or this superpower, and they worshipped the beast, or they obeyed this superpower, saying, who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? So now we have a superpower that comes out of a densely populated area who will claim to be God on earth and claim to have the power to forgive sin. And pagan Rome gave him his power, his seat, and great authority. And they worshiped the beast, saying, who is able to make war with the beast? They worship the beast, that is a religious system, and who is able to make war with the beast, that is a political system. It is a union of church and state. Let's keep going. And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. And power was given unto him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. So the superpower is a persecuting power. Again, he will blaspheme God, he will claim to be God on earth, and he will claim to have the power to forgive sin, and he will continue 42 months. That is 1260 days in prophecy, 1260 literal years. Now, what is the only entity in the world that fit these descriptions? I'm sure we all know who John was talking about now. Let's keep going. Verse 8, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Again, it's going to be a religious system. They worshiped the beast. I'm positive that most of you already know what entity John was describing in this prophecy here. Who is the beast? It is again none other than the papacy. The papacy is the only superpower that fits all of these descriptions perfectly. The papacy is a superpower that rises out of a densely populated area, who claims to be God on earth and claims to have the power to forgive sin. And we already know that pagan Rome gave the papacy its power, its seat, and great authority. The papacy is a religious system as well as a political system. It is a union of church and state. The papacy blasphemes God. The papacy is the only entity in the world that ruled for exactly 1260 years. And during those 1260 years, the papacy made war with the saints and killed the saints during a time called the Dark Ages. So this prophecy is the same as the prophecies before. In Daniel 2, God gave us a timeline, the basis of this prophecy. In Daniel 7, God gave us the same prophecy but more detail. And now in Revelation 13, God gives us the same prophecy and even more detail. Revelation 13, starting from verse 9. If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. So the Bible is saying that he that leadeth into captivity, he himself shall go into captivity. And he that killeth with the sword, the Bible and the civil power, he himself must be killed with the same exact thing, the Bible and the civil power. Now remember, the papacy ruled from 538 AD all the way to 1798 AD, which is exactly 1260 years. During those times, people used the Bible and protested against the papacy, exposing the papacy using the Bible, the sword, that the papacy was the little horn or the Antichrist of Scripture. And so many Christians back then protested against the papacy. This was the birth of Protestantism. What happened in 1798 AD? Napoleon was sick and tired of taking orders from the Pope and from the papacy, and so he sent General Berthier to go and arrest the Pope and claim Rome. The Pope then, who led people into captivity, he himself was led into captivity. So the papacy was killed with the sword, which was the Bible, and later died by the civil power in exile. He that leadeth into captivity, he himself must be led into captivity. He that killeth with the sword, he himself must be killed with the sword. The beast received his deadly wound. Now, of course, the papacy remained, but the power was taken away from the papacy. And so while the papacy was on its way down, John sees another beast that comes out of the earth. Revelation 13 verse 11, and I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. Now, who is this new beast that comes out of the earth? Let's make a list of the descriptions the Bible gives us about this second beast of Revelation 13. Number one, it is a beast, so that means it is a superpower. Number two, this superpower rises up right when the papacy was on its way down, which is in the year 1798. So this superpower will rise up around late 1700s. Number three, notice that prophecy goes from east to west. In Daniel 2 and Daniel 7, that first kingdom was Babylon. The second kingdom was Medo-Persia, which is west of Babylon. The third kingdom was Greece, which is west of Persia. And the last kingdom was Rome, which is west of Greece. Rome then gave its seat and authority to the papacy. Where then will this lamb-like beast, this superpower, rise up out of? If we follow the movement of prophecy, it should rise up in the Western Hemisphere and not the Eastern Hemisphere, in the New World and not the Old World. So characteristic number three, this superpower will rise up in the Western Hemisphere, in the New World and not the Old World. Number four, it will come up out of the earth, which is the opposite of the sea. The sea is full of water. And remember, water in Bible prophecy is a symbol for peoples, nations, and kindreds and tongues, or a densely populated area. If the earth is the opposite of a sea, then the earth must be a sparsely populated area. Number five, it will be a lamb-like beast. Now remember, the lamb is Christ. So it is a superpower with Christian values. It is a Christian nation with Christian principles. Now, what are the two horns? Remember, a horn in Bible prophecy is a symbol for kings or kingdoms or powers, or you can say two principles. The first beast had 10 horns and 10 crowns, which indicates that these 10 horns or 10 kingdoms had 10 kings. This lamb-like beast has two horns, no crowns. So it is a Christ-like nation with two Christ-like principles. Now, what are the two principles of Christ? In Matthew 22, verses 36 through 40, Jesus was being asked, "Which is the greatest commandment?" Jesus said, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." So the two principles of Christ is love God and love your neighbors. This is why God specifically wrote the Ten Commandments on two tables of stone. Not one, not three. Two tables of stone for a very specific reason. The first table, which contains the first four commandments, describes our duty towards God, governed strictly by a religious power. This is a spiritual kingdom. The second table, which contains the last six commandments, describes our duty towards man, our neighbors, governed strictly by a civil power. This is the civil kingdom. Now, these two principles were even laid out by Jesus Christ himself in Mark 12. A group of people came to ask Jesus, "Master, we know that thou art true and carest for no man, for thou regardest not the person of men, but teachest the way of God in truth. Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not? Shall we give or shall we not give?" But he, knowing their hypocrisy, said unto them, "Why tempt ye me? Bring me a penny, may I see it." And they brought it. And he saith unto them, "Whose is the image and superscription?" And they said unto him, "Caesar's." And Jesus answering said unto them, "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." So in context, God controls the religious power or the spiritual kingdom, and Caesar, today we call it the government, controls the civil power or civil kingdom. So the two principles are church and state and the separation thereof. This lamb-like beast is a Christian nation acknowledging the separation of two powers, church and state. Let's do a recap of the descriptions given to us about this second beast. Number one, it will be a beast or a superpower. Number two, it will come up around late 1700s. Number three, it will come up in the Western Hemisphere, in the New World and not the Old World. Number four, it will come up in a sparsely populated area. And number five, it will be a Christian nation that acknowledges the two principles of Christ, church principles and state principles, and the separation thereof. What is the only Christian-based superpower that rises up in the late 1700s in a sparsely populated area in the Western Hemisphere who acknowledges church and state and the separation thereof? It is none other than the United States of America. Is America a superpower? The United States of America is actually the most influential superpower in the world today since the papacy. Did it come up in the late 1700s? 1776 was the Declaration of Independence. 1783 was the end of the Revolutionary War against Great Britain. 1787, the US Constitution was framed. 1789, the US Constitution was ratified. 1789 to 1797, George Washington served as our first president. So while the papacy was going down in 1798, the United States was quietly establishing its power and dominance. Number three, did the United States of America come up in the Western Hemisphere? It is no secret that the United States of America came up in the New World in the Western Hemisphere. Even our currency states that we are established in the New World, and the United States even calls this the New World Order. Number four, did the United States come up in a sparsely populated area? When America was first discovered, this continent was barely populated. And number five, does the United States of America acknowledge church and state and the separation thereof? We have a constitution actually protecting the separation of church and state. The reason why our founding fathers came to America was because they were trying to detach themselves from the King of Britain and also from a king that runs both church and state, which is the Pope. This is the reason why we came up as a republic and a Protestant nation. Republicanism is a kingdom without a king, and Protestantism is a church without a pope. The United States of America is the only entity in the world that fit the descriptions of this second beast of Revelation 13. And John says that this second beast, the United States of America, will begin to speak as a dragon.